Is there additions? Seeing none, we'll call for the question. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Under the order of presentations, Mireille Saret of Brandon's Fair Trade Committee is here to present the Fair Trade Town of the Year Award.
Very good. Come on ahead. Welcome back. This is getting to be an annual event.
Yeah. Good evening, Your Worship, Mayor and Councilors. And sincere greetings from the Fair Trade Town Committee and the Marcos Project. Our committee and the Marcos Project have a lot to celebrate since January. We hosted our first Fair Trade Feast at the dock last evening. It was a great success. They prepared some Fair Trade specialty drinks and a three-course meal prepared with Fair Trade ingredients. It was all very delicious. We had 101 tickets sold. We sold out. And from our calculations, I think we could have sold maybe 30 more seats. So we may do one another time. And in addition to that, three of our committee members were able to go to the conference, the Canadian Fair Trade Network Conference in Halifax, February 24th to 26th. While there, the theme of the year was to learn, share, and connect, and that we did. It included really a lot of discussions about fair trade, domestic fair trade, international fair trade. And there were three keynote speakers which were absolutely fantastic, two from the Global South, one from Kenya, and another from Paraguay. The James Mwai from Kenya, he explained how fair trade saves lives and protects human rights on the continent of Africa. And Andreas Gonzalez from Paraguay, he told us how his community developed from a poor and divided entity to a more prosperous and united co-op because of fair trade. It was very inspirational to hear stories from the Global South to sort of validate what we're doing here in Brandon and in Canada. While at the conference, a joint statement entitled The Fair Trade, A Movement for All was signed by 127 organizations around the world. It states that true fair trade is about mutually beneficial relationships rooted in trust and respect, and it spans geographic and cultural boundaries. It is about shared value through supply chains, openness and transparency, and respects human rights and supports diversity. Finally, Fair Trade Canada hosted the Fair Trade annual Fair Trade Awards, and I had the honor of accepting 2016 Fair Trade Town of the Year on behalf of the city for the third year in a row. Grace Mennonite Church also won for Fair Trade Faith Group, and the city of Selkirk won for Fair Trade Workplace of the Year. So the challenge to City Council this evening is to investigate Fair Trade Workplace. You meet already quite a few of the requirements for it. It's an online application. And we need to, you know, if we want to beat Selkirk next year, I strongly recommend looking into that. So I have the award to present to you, Your Worship.
We'll come over there. I will say, when we first learned of this, we started to feel a little bad for all the other communities, because we are, you know, we like to share and whatnot, although we're also very competitive. So thrilling to win again. And I do want to say it's in no small measure to your own efforts and passion for this, and those of all your volunteers and kind of on your team and continuing to make this go forward and continuing to with the momentum and build on what we have going here throughout the city of Brandon, and certainly all the many partners, if you will, that are participating and adding to the growth of this in Brandon. So great news that we're being recognized, and everybody out there that's become a fair trade partner certainly gets to share in this. So
yeah.
I'm going to let you name on that.
The suggestion is to display all three awards at 10,000 villages, if yourself and the councillors would be in agreement for a few months?
Sure, that'd be great.
Okay, great.
And although this is presentations, unlike delegations, but I'm sure that if any member of council had a question or two for Marae, that she'd be glad to entertain any. We don't always do that, but if there were some, I certainly wouldn't want to stifle council. So Councillor Chaboyer?
Thank you, Worship. I just wanted to make a comment. I just wanted to thank the steering committee for not only making us better Brandon citizens, but better global citizens as well. So thanks for your efforts.
Councillor DeJarlis?
Echo that and delicious feast. I do the perfect chocolate and coffee and things like that. I'm a bit of a wine snob, but I had some wine yesterday that was fantastic. So I think I'm going to start looking at fair trade wine when I go into the liquor store as well. And I happened to win a yoga day for 12 people.
Hey.
So if council would like to join me, you're welcome to sit in with Marae because she's going to be the yoga instructor. For that.
Do we have to wear yoga pants?
I don't think you have to ask, but
please do.
Oh, I love yoga.
Okay. Not seeing any other questions, thank you very much
thank
to
you.
You and your team. And you're right, we'll just keep building on this.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't believe there's a motion required for that, to Madam Clerk, so we can move on to the next item.
A motion confirming the minutes of the February 21st regular meeting, Your Worship.
Councillor Harwood, seconded by Councillor Parker. Any errors, omissions, changes?
Did Your Worship?
Okay, not seeing any. We'll call for the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Under the order of public hearings, Your Worship, a public hearing to consider bylaw number 7168, which is the closure of a portion of 30th and 31st Streets, Shaw Avenue, and the north-south lane located south of Durham Drive and west of Marquis Crescent.
Very good. So we will open the public hearing to consider this matter. I'm guessing we may not have a lot of delegations in the audience for this, but we'll hold it open for a second here, as we ought to do. Okay. Not seeing anyone rushing to the podium. Motion to close the hearing would be in order. Councillor Barry.
Thank you, Worship. I'd like to move that the public hearing to close and convey these portions of 30th Street, 31st Street, Shaw Avenue, and the north-south lane in Block 16, Plan 291, BLTO, located south of Durham Drive and west of Marquis Crescent, be concluded.
Seconder, please. Councillor Harwood, whoever wishes to speak?
No, Your Worship, nothing further to add on that.
Anyone else wishing to speak? Seeing none, we'll call for the question on closing of the hearing. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. That will come up again under further business. Next item, please.
Also under public hearings, Your Worship, the public hearing regarding the City of Brandon 2017 financial plan.
And I believe we have Mr. Hammond that will start us off with a bit of an overview and presentation, and then we'll open the hearing.
Good evening, Your Worship, and members of council. So, yes, I will give some brief highlights of the 2017 financial plan. So the council approved operating budget after January's deliberations increases to $80.8 million, an increase of $900,000 or 1.1%. That's not what translates to the tax increase, which I'll show shortly, but it's interesting to note that the increase in operating spending is equal to the current Manitoba Consumer Price Index. In terms of the revenues that come with the budget, if I could draw everyone's attention to the bottom left, so that's the grants from other levels of government, and those remain essentially flat for this year. In the top left quadrant is the internally generated fees through any department that has the ability to generate fees, and we have increased that revenue line by $400,000 this year. So while grants remain flat, we have more internally generated revenue, and of course, property taxes have to make up any difference. Pardon me, my patient is funny things here.
Fill in the blanks.
Okay, I learned my lesson last time, so I do have a plan B. Okay, so in terms of the expense side of the budget, so revenues have to equal expenses. This is the traditional pie chart that I show in terms of where the operating spend goes to in terms of what services are delivered. And of note, I looked back over the last 6 years and protective services as a percentage of the operating budget has remained basically flat or it's even decreased in some years. So 6 years ago, protective services was essentially the same as it is today. It is not increasing as a percentage of budget. And also of note is that over the last 6 years, the support services has decreased from 12.5% to 10.1%. So that's traditionally what we would call the overhead portion of the budget. That's the city departments which service the other city departments. We have a very robust capital program for 2017. I think this is our second largest capital program ever. So of the almost $50 million in capital spending, almost $21 million of that is being provided by other levels of government. And so that's mainly going towards the upgrades to the dike, which is $14 million. And there's significant upgrades to the airport, which makes up the other majority of that. We are good savers, so through our general fund reserves and our utility reserves, we have roughly $28 million in capital programming going on this year, and there's a small proportion that is levied through taxes as well. It's important to note that there's no new debt for 2017 for capital projects. The borrowing for the airport terminal redevelopment, that was included in the 2016 capital plan. In terms of our debt position, even with last year's additional debt for the airport terminal upgrade, the city's overall debt position remains pretty much the same as last year. And of our $33 million in authorized debt, we're making payments through the operating budget of $3.5 million, which represents about 4.2% of operational spending. In terms of how this translates to property taxes, so this example is for what we would consider to be the average residential property. So that would typically be a approximately 40-year-old, 1,200 square foot, three-bedroom, two-bath home, assessed at a little more than $251,000. So in 2016, that property would have paid $1,793 in municipal taxes, and in 2017, that same property would now pay $1,810, which is an increase of $17 or a 0.97% tax increase. Remember, I said that the operating budget increased by 1.1%, which is equal to Manitoba inflation. In this case, property taxes are increasing at less than inflation. This is, of course, for the municipal portion of taxes only. School division taxes would be on top of that. And this chart shows where that $1,810 in municipal taxes would go. This is the same pie chart as I was showing before, broken down to an individual property. When we talk about budgets that are in the tens of millions of dollars, I always try to put that into perspective for ratepayers. And so these numbers are a little easier for people to grasp. It's interesting that for even for our largest spending category, protective services, the combined costs of police, fire, 911, and emergency management services per day, they work out to less than a cup of coffee, and total municipal services are still less than $5 a day for the typical municipal residential property. Next steps in terms of the budgeting process, with tonight's conclusion of the hearing on the financial plan, that would lead to adoption of the financial plan at the next council meeting, as well as first reading of the tax levy bylaw, and then second and third reading at the council meeting following that. When the financial plan is brought forward for adoption at the next meeting, that will include the school division numbers as well. Right now, we don't have those, although we do have a placeholder in our budget for those amounts. Some friendly reminders, if residents wish to prepay their taxes, there is discounts available. Those decline leading up to June's due date for taxes. If property owners wish to pay their taxes in installment, we can set them up on the tax installment program. And also a reminder to homeowners to make sure you are claiming your provincial homeowner tax credit of $700. You can do that through your income taxes, but it's easier to do it on your property taxes, and we can set you up on that. And also, I should speak to the senior school tax rebate. That is a provincial program, and the maximum rebate for 2016 is $470. The process has changed a little bit this year. So starting with the 2016 tax year, seniors can claim the rebate when they file their income taxes with Canada Revenue Agency. Tax forms have been made available by CRA and will include a section with instructions for claiming the rebate. So once again, that's through the province, that's not through the city. For more information on our budget or the 2017 financial plan, there is information and reports available on the city website, as well as this presentation. And with that, I would be happy to take any questions from council.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Hammond. We'll start off, Councillor Reggio.
Thank you, Your Worship. Through you to Mr. Hammond. Just a quick question. In the past week or so, we've heard some announcements from the province, major cuts in departments, and they're reducing their spending and looking at other ways. Are we pretty confident that for this year, the grants that we were told we would be getting from the provincial government will actually get?
Your Worship, to Councillor LaReggio, we haven't heard otherwise, so I'm confident that the amounts that we've budgeted for this year will come to be. Essentially, we've budgeted flat numbers, assuming that there would be no increases, but on the other hand, we're not anticipating any decreases either.
Thank you.
Yeah, Councillor Harwood next.
Thank you very much, Your Worship. Through you to Mr. Hammond. Dean, the 2017 debt, and as a percentage of the operating budget, for 2017, it's 4.2%. Where is that in relation to past years? Are we, we up a little bit or a lot, or where are we at?
Your Worship, to Councillor Harwood, it's consistent with the last few years. Of course, we pay down a portion of our debt every year, but in the last few years, we've taken on new debt as well. But our debt is one of the things that I watch closely, and I do know that compared to other Manitoba municipalities and cities, our debt levels are very low, and we're mandated to stay under provincial maximums, and we're well under the provincial allowable amounts for debt.
Your Worship, if I might, supplementary, and what, just for the benefit of those watching at home, what's the provincial ceiling? I guess at what percentage would the province start to be, concerned about our debt load? What's the ceiling percentage?
Through Your Worship, to Councillor Harwood. So the province has two ratios that we have to use, and using those, where I believe with one of them we're at 25% of the allowable amount, and with the other one we're at about 33% of the allowable amount. So in theory we could triple to quadruple our debt if we wanted to do so.
Thank you very much, Your Worship.
Councillor Fawcett.
Yes, thank you. Through your worship, actually, just along the lines of Councillor Harwood's, you do always have that slide that refers to debt. And then a previous slide is the one that shows all of our pie chart and all our service deliveries. You know, there's no debt, of course, ever in that, but the debt is included in the departments all the time.
Through your worship, to Councillor Fawcett, that's correct. So, yes. So, for example, the debt on our buildings will be included in the infrastructure pie because, of course, our buildings are municipal infrastructure. So that's where I put that cost.
This was noted where it is.
Okay. I didn't have any other hands up. I did have one question. You mentioned, Dean, at the April 3rd meeting when we begin to adopt the bylaw, at that point you'll have the school division numbers to be able to plug into the overall picture. What about the, I forget what it's called, the other provincial education levy that's levied against commercial taxpayers? Will we have that by then as well? Like, are we able to finish this out without that? Because I think last time I spoke to a few days ago, we didn't have that yet.
Yes, Your Worship. Usually the provincial education levy comes at the beginning of March. So, yes, we will have that for the adoption of the financial plan.
Councillor Cullen.
Yes, Your Worship, through you to Mr. Hammond. Our growth dividend, where does it sit as compared to other years? Like, we continue to grow. We do have a growth dividend. How does that, like, how much money was actually used in order to go toward our budget this year based on growth?
Your Worship, to Councillor Cullen, the new properties on the roll are contributing approximately $800,000 in more revenue to the city this year.
Thank you.
Okay, I didn't see any other hands up, so thanks very much, but don't go far away in case any questions come up under the hearing. Very good. So council now opens up the public hearing with respect to the 2017 financial plan, and any member of the public is welcome to come forward and make comments, ask questions perhaps, but certainly council is here to listen. Now, it is a stormy night, so I wasn't expecting we'd get a large number of people in any event, but it appears we may not have any presenters tonight. That said, a motion to conclude the hearing would be in order. Councillor Parker, would you like to read that, please?
Yes, I'd like to move that the public hearing on the City of Brandon's 2017 financial plan be concluded.
Thank you. Seconded by Councillor Reggio. Whoever wishes to speak?
Thank you, Your Worship.
Any discussion? Seeing none, we'll call for the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Thank you. Next item, Madam Clerk.
Community question period, Your Worship.
Thank you very much, by the way, Mr. Hammond. Very thorough presentation. So moving on to community question period, it's a portion on the agenda that the council holds open, a total of 15 minutes allowed to any member in the audience wishing to appear before council tonight to make any comment or question about any matter that may be on our agenda this evening. So once again, on a stormy night, we may not have many here that want to speak to an agenda item. Very good. Seeing none, move on to the next item, please.
The order of committee reports, Your Worship. I believe we have a verbal report regarding the Keystone Center.
Very good. Councillor Barry.
Thank you, Worship. I'd just like to present a report from the Keystone Center this evening. We had our last board meeting on February 23rd. First off, I'd like to start off with thank Neil Thompson for his 5.5 years of service as our general manager. Neil's last day with the Keystone was on February the 24th. During his time, of course, we had a lot of significant change in the Keystone, both facility-wise, infrastructure-wise, and that, and we certainly appreciate all the work Neil has done for the Keystone Center and want to wish him well in his future endeavors, whatever those he chooses to be. He has some options on his table as to what he'd like to do, but certainly we want to thank him publicly for all the work he's done for the Keystone and that. So there are lots of things, of course, as usual, going on at the Keystone, lots of activity at this time of year with playoffs and example trade shows and that. We have the career symposium on right now. That's going on for the next few days. This is always a busy time at the Keystone as well. Looks like the snowstorms come early, so winter fair must be around the corner somewhere in that, but might be a little bit early this year in that. One of the big challenges or things we're facing coming up in the very next probably 6 months is we have a lot of contracts up to do at the Keystone, and these contracts are usually, most of them are long-term with some of our major partners, major vendors, and they form the basis of the financial being of the Keystone, and they're very, very important to us. So we have some very important times coming up the Keystone where these contracts have to be negotiated, and they're everything from the Wheat Kings to the naming rights to our beer vendor to the Ag Days contract that's also up in that, and we've got about half a dozen of them within the next 6 months that are very important to us. So just want to make council aware of that. Some of the things that are going to be happening at the Keystone, because you're probably going to hear some different things coming out of talks and negotiations this time around than what we've had in the past, based on the needs of what the Keystone is requiring right now. And I just wanted to touch on our capital project, our five-year capital plan. Of course, that City Council granted us $500,000 last year. Unfortunately, we didn't get our provincial partners to match at that time. That time is coming up again. Council has put in their budget this year $500,000 for the Keystone Center for capital repairs to the capital fund. We're really hoping that our provincial partners, our other funding partner, takes a serious look at it this year as their budget comes up. And the reason why I'm saying that is we had plans for the $500,000 and things we wanted to do. And we talked about this with council right off the bat with our five-year capital plan is, here's what we want to do, but plans changed. And I'm here to tell you folks, plans changed real quick. And that because we had a major project that we wanted to do, which included looking at possibly doing the Canada Room hallway roof, which has been leaking like a sieve. And we had a condenser blow on us a week and a half ago to the tune of $250,000. Of which we had no money for. So what happens with our capital money is one thing we plan on doing now gets shifted over to something else, because without that condenser being replaced, basically you have no ice facilities in the whole north and in the arena, which means no curling rink, no hockey rinks, no nothing until it's replaced. So we've had to change our plans, put the money over there, but it's left us with a serious situation of a very bad leaking roof that we were hoping to get replaced this year. So while we appreciate council support and in providing the capital funds for the Keystone, we really need our provincial funding partners to step up, because we are in dire needs right now of getting some of these things fixed. This is what happens when we have to shift our money from here to here, because something happens we don't anticipate and something that we badly need to fix gets pushed out again because we don't have the funds for it. And I just wanted to kind of reiterate that tonight with council. Hopefully our provincial partners will come on board, because if they don't, you know what I'll be coming back and asking for. And it'll be in short time this year. It won't be in August. So I just wanted to relay that report to council tonight. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Councillor Barry. We'll open up questions that there may be for Keystone. Councillor Reggio.
Thank you. Maybe a suggestion, you should have the new premier stand in the hallways when the roof are leaking and might get some money like last time. with no general manager, because I haven't heard of any appointment, who will be looking after the negotiations for these new contracts? And I'll kind of slide in my favorite question, and how would this impact be impacted by the lack of a leadership review report, or will it?
Through your worship to Councillor Reggio, I'll answer the last question first. With the leadership review, the governance review that's going on really doesn't affect anything that we're doing with our day-to-day operation. So basically everything's running as normal. If nobody knew that right now we are without a general manager and came into the facility to attend an event, go to a hockey game, you know, take their kids to a hockey game, I don't think they'd notice anything different. And that's the whole intent, is we want to keep it that way. As far as what's happening with the contracts and that, we do have an appointed acting general manager interim for the time being, who is being overseen by the executive committee, which consists of myself, Councillor Lottie Patterson, Garth Rice, and Tim Hoare, who's also the vice chair. So we are kind of overseeing the interim GM at the point. As far as the contracts going, we're certainly offering advice, and there is some involvement from members of the executive committee as well as dealing with them as well, probably more from my point and with the vice chair Tim Hoare's point. To kind of get these looked after and done as well. And as we go forward, that probably won't change at all.
And just as a follow-up, I know you're negotiating or will soon start negotiating, but are you optimistic that all the previous sponsors or the existing sponsors will come on, will stay on board, that you won't be losing any funding?
Our hope going forward is that, yeah, we're going to be in a better position in 6 months than we are right now. And that means better contracts, better agreements, and that. That's our hope. That's our vision. Takes two to play ball, though, so I guess we'll see what the other sides have to say about that. So,
thank you.
Any other questions? Councillor Chaboy.
Thank you, Your Worship. It's a question perhaps to you. Is there anything that, Your Worship, that you can do through the leadership group or through this council to lobby the provincial government for these urgent requests for capital funding for the Keystone Center, because they sound quite urgent, you know, with the roof, and because it does affect our economy in the city of Brandon, what happens at the Keystone. So is there anything we can do?
Yeah, well, on the leadership side, I think we're getting fairly close to having the province get that pulled back together, because I return to that on a fairly regular basis, because frankly, that particular piece of the puzzle doesn't involve money or anything else. So there's not really, you know, a big reason to hold it up. So I think the province is getting close to getting back on top of that, and we can get that sort of cleaned up kind of once and for all. And then similarly, I think that once we have a, you know, a better process in place for the that sort of governance, if you will, that I think we can kind of accelerate matters with respect to the funding as well. I think, you know, the province has a budget coming up in about a month. So, you know, we're hopeful that, as Councillor Barry put it, that they take a serious look at the needs of the Keystone in that. And if not, then I think that as a council, I think we'll have to be sitting down with the province. We are truly partners in the facility. It's not like we're just sort of going cap in hand for this thing. It's as much theirs as it is ours, so to speak. So it could be the other way around. You know, we could be not funding it. They'd be having to come to us and say, you're going to have to pony up on your share of this thing. So I think that's going to certainly come to that.
Okay, thanks.
Didn't see any other hands up, so thanks for that. I do want to advise Council, and I want to commend particularly Councillor Barry, Councillor Patterson as well, our two representatives on the Keystone Board. They've been putting in, I happen to know, a tremendous amount of extra time right now with the, you know, general manager leaving. That, you know, always leaves additional duties to take care of. And I know that the executive and as board chair, Councillor Barry in particular has been putting in a lot of extra time on this particular appointment. And he had asked me to be reappointed to the Keystone when this council took over, and now maybe take it twice.
What you ask for, yeah, yes, may get it.
But I do want to commend you, Councillor Barry, and your whole board for really doing yeoman service in you know, keeping the Keystone operating smoothly and looking ahead. And so extend that gratitude to your whole board, and we're going to stick with you as heavily as we can.
Well, I thank you, and I'll certainly extend your thanks to the rest of the board for that. Thank you very much, Your Worship.
Okay. Very good. Any other committee reports that we may not have been aware of? Seeing none, a motion would be in order to accept the one report that we did have. Councillor Barry, seconded by Councillor Patterson. Any discussion? Seeing none, call for the question. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
The order of inquiries, Your Worship.
Very good. Councillor Brown.
Your Worship, to our acting city manager, my inquiry is about the snow being dumped in the City Mall parking lot at 18th and Richmond.
Very good. And I thank you, Councillor Brown. And I failed at the very beginning of the meeting to acknowledge the fact that due to the departure of City Manager Scott Hildebrand towards the end of February, that acting city manager, as you know, he was officially appointed last meeting to be the acting city manager, Mr. Rod Sage. And so he's no stranger to that seat. He's had to fill in numerous times. So now he'll be in that seat on a certainly much more regular basis. So thank you very much for stepping up and for being here. With that, I'll turn Councillor Brown's inquiry over to you.
Thank you, Your Worship. Through you to Councillor Brown. In speaking with the general manager at the Shoppers Mall, she has advised that there is no plan to remove the snow at this time. This does not pose a concern for the city of Brandon because the drainage problem at 18th and Richmond is caused by high volume storms in the summer. Snow melts at a much slower rate and will not impact the drainage at this intersection. In addition, the mall has controlled drainage on its property, which will also assist with the snow melt.
Thank you.
Okay, very good. We weren't aware of any other inquiries, but in case any came up. I'm going to take a little liberty, though, and make one, and pardon me to the acting city manager, but we did talk about this morning. So we are in the middle of a blizzard, and so in the event anybody thinks that we thought we were out of the clear and put all the equipment away, you perhaps could just give us a comment or two about what will be happening likely over the next 24 to 72 hours or whatever it takes.
Absolutely, Your Worship. Very timely. This evening, I just been advised by Public Works staff. Ms. Pam Penner has indicated that there's two sanders that will be on all evening. So they will be touring around the city and ensuring that all of our arterial and collector streets are well sanded and cleared for residents in the early morning commute to work. Depending on how much snowfall arrives tonight, we do have staff that will be up very early in the morning assessing the condition of our streets. Staff today were advised to be on call, and in the event that we have to call them in early, they are aware that they could get an early call depending on how much snow comes tonight. If snowfall is in the range of that 5 to 10 centimeters, staff will be in first thing at 8 a.m. in the morning and we'll start to clear our arterials and collectors as we normally would based on our snow clearing policy. If we happen to get a larger dump of snow, if Mother Nature wants to test us again, based on the snowfall we had at Christmas, Public Works staff have reviewed some of their policies and procedures, and rest assured, if we need additional equipment, we are in a much better position now to acquire the resources of contractors as needed, based on the snow accumulations tonight and tomorrow.
Very good. Thanks for that. I'm sorry I blindsided you on that, but kind of a timely topic once again, sadly. Next item, Madam Clerk.
The order of announcements, Your Worship.
Any announcements tonight? Seeing none, I think everyone's anxious to get home before we're stormed in here. So, next item, please.
The order, under the order of general business, Your Worship, the tender for the 8th Street Bridge demolition.
Councillor DeJarlais.
Thank you, through Your Worship. I move that the bid of Shawn Anderson Demolition and Construction Limited for the 8th Street Bridge demolition as per tender and specifications at a cost of $562,219.13 be accepted. And further, that the project cost be funded from the 8th Street Bridge Reserve.
Seconder, please. Councillor Harwood. Mover wish to speak.
Maybe a little bit later, but perhaps Mr. Pulak would like to give us more of the finer details of the tender.
That would be a good idea. Thank you.
Your Worship, Council, I'd just like to begin by saying that usually the number of bids and the prices we get in any tenders is a good indication of the competitive of the market. I was pleased to see that we received 8 bids during this tendering process. Further to that, the bid we did receive, the low bid, which we are get accepted tonight, is significantly lower than our pre-tender estimate. With that said, for the people who don't know, Shawn Anderson and Demolition and Construction Limited is the same company that was hired by MI, Manitoba Infrastructure, to demolish the First Street Bridge. So they certainly, in my mind, had a bit of a competitive edge in here in the fact that they've already mobilized and they've been working with CP to coordinate their activities. If Council accepts this bid tonight, the plan going forward is to, within the next 2 or 3 weeks, to have a pre-construction meeting with the company. And then, based on the schedule, they will issue a a construction or a timeline as to when the demolition will take place. They do have till September 30th to complete the demolition. So there's plenty of time within that time period, and certainly it'll be based on really when they can mobilize and the coordination they would have to have with CP.
Very good. We'll open it up for questions. Mr. Pulak, Councillor Harwood.
Thank you very much, Your Worship. Through you to Mr. Pulak. Pat, noticed on the second page of your report, it says with additional costs anticipated for project management, and I'm looking at site supervision by CP Rail. I may wonder maybe if you could, I was just wondering what that involves with the CP Rail, and maybe if you could expand on that for us, please.
Certainly. Through you to Councillor Hayward. Sorry. At First Street, MI had to work through CP Rail, so there has to be a coordination of activities. We got five tracks going across there. At no time can all of those tracks be shut down. There has to always be two to three tracks open. So there has to be that coordination. So what CP does is, and what they've done in this case, is they've turned to us and said, listen, we will assign a person from CP to work with you, and we have to pay for that person. And what they do is they act as the liaison between ourselves and CP and the contractor, ensuring that at no time are we interfering with rail traffic. So,
okay, good. Thank you very much, Your Worship.
And Councillor Patterson.
Thank you, Your Worship. This may need someone else from admin to answer, but I am curious, once we start in the demolition process, that is going to limit access to people that use the bridge on foot or, well, maybe not cycling right now. So I'm just curious if there's been any work to help those folks get from where they are to downtown.
Worship to Councillor Patterson. One of the things that we have considered and we're still continuing to work with transit on is perhaps some sort of a transportation or a special route that would take residents from that area to the bus mall. It's certainly something we have to have in place before we would move forward with the demolition. So it's just an issue of getting that, working with transit and seeing what we can do.
Thank you.
Well, there are many discussions in the works, so I think everyone is abundantly aware of that piece. So, as Mr. Pulak put it, we certainly want to have provisions in place before they, in essence, close the bridge. So, Councillor Reggio.
Thank you. My question is more, Patrick, after the bridge has been demolished with the two access points on either side, will they be cordoned off with just concrete barriers, or can you give us an idea of, have we thought that far ahead?
Through Your Worship to Councillor Reggio, we've certainly had that discussion with CP. They're fully aware of, well, as it stands right now, even with the bridge in place, they do have an issue with pedestrians crossing the tracks, and there have been incidents. The question is what kind of barrier can you put in place that would be sufficient enough to eliminate that altogether? So certainly they have a fence in place now. That doesn't seem to be working. I know CP is looking into it based on the discussions I had with them last time they were here in the city. We will continue to work with them to find a method that we can put in place to try, one, certainly to block that where the 8th Street Bridge was before, but also to try and eliminate or reduce significantly the amount of pedestrian traffic across the tracks.
Just as a follow-up, because we're working with CP, will this be cost-shared if we have to put in concrete barriers or a chain-link fence? Are they going to help pay for some of that because it's to their interest also?
Through Your Worship, to Councillor Reggio, without getting too ahead of myself, certainly my opinion of the matter is it's their property. Instinctively, you'd say it's their property. They must build the fence, but certainly as it impacts residents of Brandon, we certainly work towards them, towards a solution. Whether or not we actually would cost share that, that's still up for debate.
Thank you.
Councillor DeJarlais.
Thank you, through Your Worship. So part of the discussion was the March 13th, 2016 council meeting where we agreed to demolish the bridge, but the second component there was that we would look for replacement of possibly pursuing an active transport bridge and looking at some, exploring some options. So I'm wondering if you can just give us a general idea where we're going with that and how far along we are.
Yep. Through you, Worship, Councillor Desjardins. So we have been working with the consultant. About a month ago, we held a brainstorming session, an internal brainstorming session, where we had administration in attendance, as well as a representative from CP. And what we were trying to do was generate ideas, and then based on that, the consultant would go away and try and come up with three or four ideas that, one, we could take forward to council, and two, that we could take out to have an open house to get input back from the public. That said, what our goal is by the end of this month to have those three or four options prepared, and then based on that, prepare a session with council and also an open house. So my thought process is both those things can be accomplished by the end of April.
Thanks.
Glad you brought that up. I was going to ask Patrick to update council on that piece as well. So Councillor Chaboy.
Thank you, Your Worship. Without getting too technical on what's going to happen with the contract with this vendor to take down the bridge, have you also entertained looking at the liabilities that could be involved? Because it is a large structure, and who would be responsible for if there was damage to the rail tracks or loss of income for us stopping their business from flowing through the tracks? Has all that been considered in your contract and with this project?
Through Your Worship to Councillor Chaboyer. That's built into the tendering and contract. The contractor must have insurance, liability insurance. They must have bonds in place to ensure good workmanship. So all the liability rests on the contractor. They must prove to us, and they must show us proof of insurance and bonds prior to any work beginning. So, and that is determined prior. The extent of coverage is determined prior to the construction. So when they make their bid, they're fully aware of the insurance that they have to have. So that's, you know, the price that we see in the bid will cover the insurance, that the premium they would have to pay in order to have that insurance.
Thank you. That's reassuring to hear.
And I'd say it's also reassuring that the recommended bidder does happen to be the contractor that's been doing the demolition on the First Street Bridge on behalf of the provincial government in conjunction with CP Rail. So obviously they had to satisfy those requirements currently for approximately the last year while they've been working on it. There have been things going fine, so there's a little bit of comfort knowing it's the same contractor just moving eight blocks to the west. Not seeing any other questions. Thank you very much, Mr. Pulak. Is there any further discussion? Back to the mover, Councillor Desjardins. Any other discussion on the matter before we call the question? Seeing none, we will call the question then. All those in favor of the motion? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Consideration of the tenant improvements at 638 Princess Avenue.
Councillor Desjardins, again, everything in your ward tonight.
Through Your Worship, I move that authorization be granted to issue a request for proposals to the design build of tenant improvements to the basement of the A.R. McDiarmid Building at 638 Princess Avenue, with such tenant improvements to be funded from the Municipal Building Reserve and to be recovered by means of a lease agreement with the Brandon School Division.
Seconder, please. Councillor Patterson. A mover wish to speak. I don't know if we have...
Again, perhaps somebody from administration.
Yeah, I'm not sure if he's ready to speak to this. So Mr. Hammond is.
So to give a bit of history for the benefit of the public at home, so last fall, Brandon School Division issued a request for information for provision of lease space. The City of Brandon responded to that request for information, and we have space available in the basement of the A.R. McDiarmid Building downtown. That space was deemed to be suitable to the school division, and so we have a pending lease agreement in place. That lease agreement has been approved on their side, both through their budget process and also by the public schools finance board. So as part of the lease agreement, there is renovations that are necessary to do upgrades to the basement. Now, we do have preliminary pricing, and the recovery of the capital component of those lease improvements are built into the rental rates with the school division. The nature of this report is that as part of the next steps, the city needs to issue a request for proposals for the design build of the necessary base or capital improvements to the basement. And with that, we will receive more firm pricing, which will of course come back to council for approval. And the end goal here is that we get the Brandon School Division into the basement for their off-campus programs starting in the fall of this year.
Good. Any questions of Mr. Hammond? Councillor Reggio?
It's kind of traditional, I believe, that the leasehold improvements, it's usually up to the person leasing the property to pay for it. So why are we renovating the building for the tenant? Out of curiosity.
Through your worship, to Councillor LaReggio, in this case, it was a request of the school division that they wanted us to take on the capital improvements, which we're fine with. We often do that nature of work through our property section and our engineering division, so it made more sense that we would tackle that in this case rather than them, and then just essentially add the costs onto their lease rates.
So just another question, Your Worship. Is this fair market value? We're not, my concern is we might be subsidizing another taxpayer-funded body. And in other words, we're subsidizing the school board. And I'm just curious, so are we, is it a fair market value?
Through Your Worship, to Councillor LaReggio, that's a great question. And in this case, because of the nature of the agreement with the tenant, we want everything to be above board in this situation. So there's two components to this lease. There's the rental portion, which I would suggest is very much fair market value, as well as the capital portion, which is the recovery of the costs necessary for the renovations to that space. So yes, it is fair market value.
This is another quick follow-up then. Because we have an estimate on the renovation costs, if the costs come in at a higher, can we adjust the rent, or is that etched in stone? And
through Your Worship, to Councillor LaReggio, there's a contingency built in right now, and as I mentioned, we do have preliminary pricing on the costs of the renovations, and the engineering section is very confident that the pricing we receive will come in at that price. And as I mentioned, the lease rate is pending now. Nothing is set in stone, but we do have a tentative agreement.
Thank you.
Hey, Councillor Berry was next.
Thank you, Worship, to Mr. Hammond. I'm going to take this one step a little bit further here. We have a potential lease agreement based on that amount. We have a preliminary amount that we know we're going to need for lease improvements. So out of the $126,335, how much are we actually getting for rent? And how much of that money is actually going to a debenture for the leasehold improvements?
Through Your Worship, to Councillor Berry, correct me if I may not be exact on this, but I believe the annual lease is $88,000, which works out to $11 a square foot, and then the remainder is the capital portion plus interest, which would be recovered over the 10-year term of the lease.
Great, thank you.
Councillor DeJarle.
Thank you, through Your Worship. It's not really a question about this agreement itself, but this is the off-campus for students who are not in school, who are finding another way to get their education, like the Neyland off-campus and things like that. And you know, we have a youth activity center at the Aaron McDermott. I'm just wondering if we've talked community development, and is there plans in place to ensure, you know, safety and security of the students or the kids that are going to be using the youth activity center, because the 75 kids are going to be using Neyland off campus are struggling students, might have some social issues, and you know, some of them might want to use youth activity center. I'm not saying you want to segregate, but there might be some some social issues that arise from them accessing that. So I'm just wondering if there's any been any conversation between community development or the Brandon School Division.
Through your worship to Councillor DeJarlay, in terms of the potential security issues of that space, I know that was very much a concern of the Brandon School Division. So I wasn't involved in all the discussions, but through the discussions between the Brandon School Division and the engineering section, part of these renovations do take into account those security needs, and those renovations do incorporate some of those security issues. As far as any other conversations with community development, I don't know if that's taken place or not.
Good. Completely separate entrances, I believe.
Yes, and secured entrances.
Okay. Councillor Chaboyer was next.
Thank you, Worship. Through to the presenter. Just trying to get my head around, I can't remember how much space we actually have on the lower level of the building. How much square footage was the entire building space on the lower level? This is 8,000 square feet, so I'm just trying to see if it's half the space or a quarter.
Through your worship to Councillor Chaboyer, I'm not sure the entire floor space of the entire building. What Brandon School Division is looking at leasing is probably a better part of the west side of the basement section. Now, the basement's kind of already chopped up. We have our backup 911 center in that facility as well. So if you've been in the basement, you know where the three large rooms and the previous kitchen area is. So it's that area, plus I believe there's another section in behind. So the majority of the western half of the basement.
Approximately half?
I'm guessing it's maybe even a little more than half, two-thirds.
Okay, I didn't have any other names down, so thanks very much for handling that, Mr. Hammond. Coming back to the motion, the mover was Councillor DeJarlay, who wished to speak. You're fine. Councillor Patterson was seconder. Any other further discussion? I will say this, to me, is a rather positive development. We've got a sizable amount of space in the lower level of that building that's, sitting empty, so certainly a city asset that's not returning anything. Also a community asset that could be used. Same token, I think from a purely kind of a leasable standpoint, I think we'd be a little bit mindful that, you know, we would need something that's kind of coexists with our AR McDiarmid uses a little more. So certainly partnering with the school division, you know, they're kind of a partner with us in the first place. So certainly probably a fairly suitable scenario for both parties. Certainly provide some revenue back to the city taxpayers for asset that they own. By the same token, I understand that the off-campus program is been very successful and continues to grow, and I think that's the reason that I think they've outgrown the premises they've had. In fact, I think they've outgrown it twice, and so probably will be a very useful space for them as well. So probably a win-win scenario for everybody. So with no further discussion, we'll call for the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Consideration of a resolution for the application for the designated heritage grant for the stone fence restoration.
Councillor Harwood.
Your Worship, whereas the City of Brandon is the owner of the municipal heritage site located in the 100 block of 17th Street, Brandon, Manitoba, known as the Stone Fence. Now, therefore, the Council of the City of Brandon duly assembled resolves as follows: that the City of Brandon make application to Manitoba Sport, Culture, and Heritage for a grant under the Designated Heritage Building Grants Program for an amount of up to $25,000 for the purpose of temporarily bracing and rehabilitating the Stone Fence Municipal Heritage Site. And further, that City Council of Brandon guarantee that there are adequate funds to complete the project, and the City of Brandon will continue to be responsible for the maintenance of this structure.
Seconder, please. Councillor DeJarlay. Mover wish to speak?
Your Worship, we'll start just with a little bit of background. We are this application for a grant from the province came about as discussions we had at budget time. We had brought a dollar figure to council, and when it was reduced down to $25,000, there was discussion around the table, and there was a question that had come up: would we, apply to the province to see if there were other grants available? Which is, what we are going to do. And at our most recent MHAC meeting, we had talked about possible options, range from doing nothing until the city provides sufficient funding to restore the fence in a future budget, or there was the option three, which is what we have agreed to do, remove the trees causing damage to the fence and temporarily brace the fence to prevent further leading until funding is available to restore the structure. And as the committee, we did after some discussion, we agreed to pursue option three. And while it's not going to be the most aesthetically pleasing result, the structure will brace the fence, and we kept that in mind when we recognized that public safety and structural integrity needed to be addressed immediately. So anyway, there was consultations with city administration, and the cost estimates received to date have revealed that a partial restoration of the fence can be undertaken within the budget. And at the same time, we will be, pursuing grants from the province. And of course, there are four criteria that the city, as the owner of the structure, must meet for the application to move ahead. And the city does meet those criteria. So that's what. This is the purpose of the recommendation before us tonight, is to make that application, Your Worship.
That was a good explanation, Councillor Harwood. Seconder wish to speak, Councillor DeJarlie.
Thank you, through Your Worship. Councillor Harwood did a very good job outlining that. One added thing was that there was some discussion about pursuing other options for funding through either private or corporate sponsorship to actually restore the fence, because there are a few on MHAC who still see the value in the fence in its entirety being restored to its heritage value. So,
okay. Councillor Cullen.
Yes, Your Worship. My concern is with the last statement. I see it a little open-ended as compared to our discussions at budget. The City of Brandon guarantees that there is adequate funding available to complete the project. So when I don't know what that cost is, and I'm just trying to get my head wrapped around how that got snuck in there, because we're just kind of at the point we were trying to sort of figure out, okay, what's it going to cost for interim safety or interim project to try to, to figure out where we're at. Now we're saying we're going to guarantee that no matter what happens, we're going to fix this thing. So it's I'm just a little leery here.
Well, the reason it's in there is that the grantor, like the province of Manitoba, it's a sort of a standard requirement that they need the proponent to be capable of finishing the project. They don't want to give you a $25,000 grant and then you go and you, as the applicant, we really only had $10,000 and we got halfway through this and the project is sat unfinished and the province has paid their money and the project didn't get to be done, so they won't enter into an agreement typically unless they have a proponent that can guarantee they got the rest of the money and that they'll finish the project that's been applied for.
So that,
follow me?
Again, that makes sense to me. However, I'm still let's say that we didn't get this grant. Where does this particular motion leave us?
Well, us guaranteeing the funds is just in light of applying for this grant. All this motion is doing tonight is really authorizing MHAC to apply for this grant from the province. And if we don't get it, we don't get it. So if we don't get it, the MHAC still has the same budget that council budgeted for at budget time. So in essence, we're trying to lever the money that the council provided by applying for some provincial money that we can do more.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Parker.
Thank you, Worship. I agree with Councilor Cullen, and that's the exact point I was going to make when he said it. And the explanation offers a little bit of comfort, but not really. I still feel that the way it's worded and the way you explained it, that if the province gives us $10,000 or $15,000 or $25,000, ultimately we still, if it's $100,000 or $110,000 as was suggested at budget time, there's still a gap there. It still looks to me like we're going to need to put in $60,000 or $80,000 at some point to finish the project. If there's a way that you can make that concern disappear, I'd sure love to hear it.
Yeah, go ahead, Councilor Harwood.
Yeah, Your Worship, if I might, under the in the background that we have, and it's on page 2 of 3, and the paragraph just above the explanation about seeking provincial funding, and it said, the cost estimates received to date revealed that a partial restoration of the fence can be undertaken within the budget. So within the $25,000, you know, we can do the partial restoration. And I think it's important, through Your Worship, to Councillor Cullen and Councillor Parker, this will involve the deconstruction and the reconstruction of the central section of the damaged portion of the stone fence. And this is the section, or the 25 feet in length, is the section that is the that is experiencing the heaviest damage. It's the piece that where we're talking about here, because this is the part that really needs the restoration. We get that done, then down the road we look at the rest of it. But right now it's that center section that is the big worry, and from a from a safety perspective as well. So that's where we're going with this. So,
Councilor Yarley.
Your Worship, just to add to that, when MHAC met last, the reason why the fourth one is in there, MHAC to seek sponsors or gifts from private and corporate interests to provide the extra funding needed to restore the fence, was an acknowledgement that they know there's no more money coming from City Council for the restoration of the fence.
Right.
So maxed out at 25 grand. So if they're going to restore the fence to its initial beauty, they're going to have to find other sources, and that was the request. But they recognize there's no more money coming from City Council for the fence.
So I wonder, Madam Clerk, to satisfy the queries of some councillors, if in the and further that Council of the City of Brandon guarantee to the province that there are adequate funds available to match any grant. Is that help?
And perhaps Mr. Nicol can confirm this, but I believe this is the standard wording that the province requested.
Oh, okay.
On the application form.
Okay. Thank you. Councillor Parker, had your hand up again.
Yes, thank you.
We're just there.
Is there a clarification? Has the scope of the project changed to just the 25 feet or whatever that area is from the entire length that was originally presented at budget? Is that why we're not?
That's why we're, excuse me, Your Worship, through you to Councillor Parker. That's why we're doing that one section. That's it appears in the report that it's the part that is the most damaged, and the one that is the big problem. It's that 25 feet.
So sorry, just if I can respond, your. Originally, the request was to do the entire fence or fix as much as was needed to be done, and now we're reducing that project to that specific 20 or 25 foot section to repair. I mean, originally the estimate was $110,000, so that's why I'm losing the disconnect there. Why suddenly we're not on the hook for the entire project? And it's the wording just would suggest to us that was the case, and I'm more than happy just to go along if that's not the case. I just don't see where it says that.
Well, in the first part of the motion where it talks about the purpose of temporarily bracing and rehabilitating the fence, you know, that's certainly a clue, like that's certainly far off of what the proposal, like that $110,000 proposal, remember, was to actually dismantle the thing stone by stone and catalog them and then fix the foundation and then recreate the fence back stone by stone. So that's, you know, that $110,000 project is certainly decidedly different than this temporarily bracing scope. So to me, that kind of, I think the fact remains is that council has budgeted $25,000, and you can apply for up to $35,000 on a matching basis. We only have $25,000 to play with, but it's also acknowledged that typically most of the grants from the province are far under their $35,000 maximum, and they're frequently $8,000. So we may get, this application may get us another $8,000 or $10,000, maybe it's $25,000, and it'll just enhance a little bit the $25,000 that council's already budgeted. But under no circumstances can we sign a contract to do more than what council has authorized to spend. So I think that, you know, apart from what this motion says, our budget caps the amount that anyone's authorized to spend on this project. So Councillor Reggio was next.
Thank you, Your Worship. I have a similar concern as to Councillors Cullen and Parker, and I was wondering, could we not add adequate funds available to complete the project, not to exceed the $25,000 we have and the potential $8,000, or not to exceed, say, $33,000? Can something like that be added in there? That way we have assurances and...
It's already in there.
It's already there.
But not on the application here, not on our motion.
The motion. We apply for a grant for an amount of up to $25,000. It's a 50-50 grant,
and
so all we're applying for is the $25,000 that's been budgeted.
Yeah, no, but I'm looking at the line down there that says to complete the project, and I want to put
that would be the $25,000 project that we're asking for fund. Like, we're not applying for the $110,000
project. Partial restoration.
We're applying for a partial project.
I think that's what is hanging yeah. people up, is that we remembered the project was this $110,000 yeah. project. That's no longer the project. Project is now this temporary bracing and
yeah.
go ahead, Councillor
Your Harvey. Worship, if I might, again, back on page 2 of 3, and the last line on that paragraph, it says the, or the last two sentences, the section 8 meters at 25 feet in length is experiencing the heaviest damage and needs to be addressed immediately. MHAC therefore will now pursue a partial restoration of the stone fence, and the partial restoration being that heavily damaged 25-foot section.
Through Your Worship, just add to that, which is under $25,000 to repair. That's they've done a pre-cost estimate. They're actually under budget, so it's not going to be 25 okay, to do
because
that.
Because part of this says we're going to apply for a grant of up to $25,000, yeah. and then it says in the next one we will guarantee the full cost of the project.
No. If I may, it's just to see if we can get some extra money from the province yeah. to help offset the $25,000 that we're, so instead of it being $25,000, it might be $17,000. And we'll get $8,000 from the province. That's what this is
That's
for.
Right.
We're just trying to add, we're just trying to find more money. We were asked to find more money, so we're trying to find more money.
We got their head around this now. I understand council's reluctance, but it just sounds like that we're going to complete the project, which was previously $110,000, but under different circumstances, there's no authority to do that. So, okay, any further discussion? Councillor Patterson.
Thank you. I just wanted to acknowledge and thank both the committee and city staff for hearing the debate around the table when we talked about this, and that we did want to see them pursue some outside funding to help with this restoration project. And I think that the proposal that's been brought forward responds to that. So I just wanted to thank the committee and city staff for doing this work.
Okay. Any further discussion? Mover could close. Counselor Harwood.
Your Worship, I think we've had a very full discussion on this and would call for the question, please.
Very good. Call for the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Thank you. Next item, please.
The appointments to the Planning Commission, Your Worship.
Councillor Fawcett.
Thank you, through Your Worship, that the following citizen members be hereby appointed to the Planning Commission with term of office to begin April 1st, 2017 and expire March 31st, 2020. Mary Jo Abbott and Andrew Sidlicky.
Seconder, please. Councillor Chaboy. Mover wish to speak?
Through Your Worship, these new appointments, there was three applications that came in for them. These are the two that were voted on, and a three-year term.
Very good. Any further discussion? None. Call for the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Under the Order of Bylaws, Your Worship, bylaw number 7155, which is an amendment to the zoning bylaw regarding snow disposal site regulations.
Councillor Fawcett.
Thank you, through Your Worship, that bylaw number 7155 to amend zoning bylaw number 7124 to regulate snow disposal facilities to be read a second time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Reggio, mover wish to speak?
No, through Your Worship.
Okay. Seconder wish to speak? By way of explanation, we do have we do impose some rules and regulations as to where contractors or residents could just go and pile snow and take into account drainage considerations and the like. So this bylaw does help to tidy that up. Any further discussion? If not, we'll call for the question on second reading. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Third reading would be in order. Councillor Fawcett.
Thank you, through Your Worship, that the bylaw be read third and final time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Barry, mover wish to speak?
I will just follow up with what you were going on there, Your Worship. All we're doing is including some provisions, definitions for snow disposal facility and water body, minimum buffering distances from a snow disposal facility to any residential or water body, a reference to the Transportation Association of Canada design guidelines for locating and designing a snow disposal facility, and we are including snow disposal facility in Table 15, Industrial Use Table, as permitted is in the IG Industrial General, and Industrial Heavy Zone as a conditional use in the Industrial Restricted Zone. So, and I haven't heard any follow-up from anybody on this, so I've been comfortable with it.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, we're going to call for the question on third reading. Once again, third reading requires a recorded vote. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried unanimously. Next item, please.
Bylaw number 7156, which is also a housekeeping amendment to the zoning bylaw regarding the rezoning of some city-owned properties and an update to the zoning map.
Councillor Fawcett.
Thank you, through Your Worship. That bylaw number 7156 to amend zoning bylaw number 7124 to rezone city-owned properties and update the zoning map legend to be read a second time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Parker, mover wish to speak?
Through Your Worship, this, I don't know if this is actually on an annual basis, but a regular basis just to do an update is...
Yeah, not annual, but certainly the periodic.
It's a housekeeping.
Well, taking some things that were properly and improperly zoned and putting them in the correct zone, like taking them from the zone, like it might be a booster station that's sitting in a single family general zone, but then would make it into an open space or park space zone. So those kind of cleanups. Any further discussion? Councillor Barry.
Thank you, Your Worship. I just have one question at this point. I don't know who can answer it, but out of the 59 owned properties, only one's being rezoned under DR Development Reserve Zone. Could we find out where that is?
Okay, Mr. Nicholas here. We do have a list. Thank you. on that one, Ryan. It says here that it's parcels reserved for extension of Quail Ridge Drive.
Okay. Yeah, through your worship, Councilor Barry, thank you for helping me find it. So that's the portion to the north of Braycrest. Monterey Estates is to the east of there, and then there's I think it's Whistler Landing right now on the other side to the west. So Quail Ridge Drive right there was kind of took on the zoning of the surrounding properties. It's a common practice if there's a road or something like that, it just development reserve, which is just a holding zone.
Thank you, Worship.
Well, Ryan's up. Any further discussion or questions? Apparently not. Thank you, Mr. Nickel.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Seeing none, mover wish to close?
No, through your worship, it's just some fine tuning.
Very good. Going to call for the question then on second reading. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. And third reading would be in order. Councillor Fawcett.
Thank you. That the bylaw be read a third and final time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Chaboyer. Whoever wishes to speak?
No. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, once again, third reading, recorded vote required. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried unanimously. Next item, please.
Bylaw number 7168, which is to close a portion of 30th and 31st Street, Shaw Avenue, and the north-south lane located south of Durham Drive and west of Marquis Crescent.
Councillor Barry.
Thank you, Worship. The bylaw number 7168 to close and convey those portions of 30th Street, 31st Street, Shaw Avenue, and the north-south lane in Block 16, Plan 291, located south of Durham Drive and west of Marquis Crescent, or Marquis Crescent, as some pronounce it, to the property owner of 1730th Street at a purchase price of $60,680 plus GST, and that portion of 30th Street, Parcel B, to the property owner of 62 Marquis or Marquis Crescent, however you wish to pronounce it, at a total purchase price of $2,750 plus GST, be read a second time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Parker. Mover wish to speak?
Thank you, Your Worship. This has been a process that's been going on for just over a year now where they've been looking at closing a couple of these lanes and putting the offer out to residents in the area. It's come back a couple times where a solution came to be that this was probably the best option for us to these two residents to purchase the lanes are looking at closing down on that and kind of going forward. That. So, but it was offered out to other people as well that just couldn't get a worked out deal on it and that. So.
Very good. Seconder wish to speak?
No, thank you, Your Worship.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, we can call for the question then. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Third reading would be in order. Councillor Barry?
Let the bylaw be read a third and final time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Harwood? Whoever wishes to speak?
No, Your Worship.
Seconder?
Nope. It's good, Your Worship.
Before I do call, I will say that an individual that was an agricultural producer recently called the staff of my office to advise us that it is pronounced Marquis because right. the areas there are various varieties of wheat, of which Marquis is a wheat variety, and apparently that is once and for all the correct pronunciation, and this person took the time to
like that duly noted in the minutes of the meeting tonight, Your Worship.
So there you go. Just thought I'd give you a little piece of valuable information. Councillor Harwood seems to know that already, but good piece of information. So we're going to call for the question on third reading. Once again, recorded vote. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried unanimously as well. Next item, please.
Bylaw number 7171, which is to name a street located in the Summit development south of Braycrest Drive and east of 18th Street as Summit Way.
Councillor Fawcett.
Thank you, through your worship. That bylaw number 7171 to name the street in the Summit development located south of Braycrest Drive and east of 18th Street and, as Summit Way be read a first time.
Seconder, please. Councillor Chaboyer. Now, this is first reading, not normally debatable, although I can't tell you how excited I am that a city on the prairie is going to have a street named Summit Way, so that's exciting in itself. So we'll call for the question on first reading. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Next item, please.
Giving of notice, Your Worship?
Any giving of notice this evening? Seeing none, call for the next item.
A motion to adjourn would be in order.
Councillor Barry, seconded by Councillor Chevoyer. All those in favor? Opposed? That is carried. Thank you very much.